Between June 1941 and February 1942, the Third Reich and the Soviet Union clashed in a titanic struggle which changed the course of history. In the battle for Russia, the German Wehrmacht, the most highly trained and successful military machine on Earth, attempted to defeat the Red Army and win for Germany a vast Eastern Empire. The result was a collision of unprecedented violence. Beginning with the German invasion and culminating in the fight for Moscow, more men, tanks, guns, and aircraft were committed to the inferno than had ever before been thrown into any battle. With each side led by an unscrupulous dictator and each army driven by a pitiless ideology, war was waged with a ferocity and barbarism up to then unimaginable. To Adolf Hitler, the assault on the Soviet Union was meant to bring a victory unmatched in the annals of warfare. In reality, the battle for Russia would end in disaster for Germany. Instead of a lightning conquest, the Wehrmacht would suffer a catastrophic defeat, a defeat that would mark the beginning of the end for Hitler's Reich. In Moscow, on August the 23rd, 1939, Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union signed an agreement which shocked the world. The Third Reich, the most violently anti-communist regime in existence, had agreed to cooperate with Stalin's dictatorship. Each undertook not to attack the other, and huge quantities of Soviet food, oil, and minerals would be exchanged for German manufactured goods. There was also a secret protocol, a protocol which assigned to Germany and Russia their own spheres of influence in Europe, areas in which the other would not interfere. For Adolf Hitler, the agreement came just in time. His armies were already massing on the Polish border, and he needed an absolute assurance from the Russians that they would not intervene if he invaded. 8 days after the signing of the Nazi-Soviet pact, German armies surged across Polish frontiers. For the Poles, struggling desperately in the face of the Nazi tide, the German-Soviet pact quickly took on a chilling reality. 2 weeks into the battle, the Red Army invaded Poland from the east. With German connivance, the Soviets were to take more than half the country. Within a few days of Hitler's attack on Poland, Britain and France had declared war on Germany. To Joseph Stalin, the sight of the great European powers at each other's throats was deeply satisfying. It was a priceless opportunity to seize yet more territory with little fear of opposition. Anxious to strengthen his northern flank, Stalin demanded strategically important areas of Finland. He was refused, and on November the 30th, 1939, 29 divisions of the Red Army attacked across Finnish borders. Russian forces were deployed in 5 armies. In the south, the main blow was struck by 7th and 13th armies, pushing across the Karelian isthmus. To the world's amazement, the Finns checked the advance. In the north, the Russian 14th Army cut off the port of Petsamo on the Arctic coast, a strategically important nickel mining area. However, in the center, the Soviets suffered humiliating defeats. The most costly when a penetration by 9th Army was completely cut off and destroyed. The battle for Finland lasted 4 months, during which a Finnish army of only 9 divisions fought with exceptional determination. The terrain was a wilderness of lakes and forests, greatly favoring the defenders. And it was only when the Soviets brought up another 11 divisions, more armor and heavy air power, that the Red Army made a significant breakthrough. In March 1940, the Finns were forced to sue for peace. To the Red Army, which had thrown 1 million men into the battle, the cost of the Finnish war was almost 200,000 killed. But the real damage was even greater. In the eyes of the world, the much-vaunted Soviet armed forces looked incompetent and utterly ineffective. Less than a month after the end of the Soviet-Finnish War, Adolf Hitler launched his own campaign of conquest in Scandinavia. On April the 9th, Norway and Denmark were invaded by land, sea, and air. The invasions were carried out with ruthless efficiency. The Germans had complete control of the skies, and in spite of interventions by the British Royal Navy and a Franco-British expeditionary force, within weeks, all of Denmark and most of Norway were in German hands. However, for the Western Allies, the worst blows were yet to come. On May the 10th, 1940, 7 German armies, spearheaded by powerful armored formations, struck at France and the Low Countries. For the campaign in the West, the Germans deployed 3 army groups. Army Group A in the center was given most of the armored formations. Facing the Wehrmacht were the Belgian and Dutch armies, 3 French army groups, and a highly mobile British expeditionary force. In the north, Army Group B swept into Holland and northern Belgium, drawing the French and British up to meet them. In the center, Army Group A, spearheaded by its panzer groups, bypassed the fortifications of the Maginot Line, smashed through thin French defenses, and raced into the interior. The tanks then swung north to reach the Channel coast. By May the 27th, most of the Allies' best divisions and almost all their mobile formations were trapped in a huge cauldron. By June the 5th, the pocket had been all but eliminated, and the British had been evacuated from Dunkirk. The main German effort now switched to the south. And 4 days later, Army Group B reached the Seine below Paris. Army Group A broke through on May the 12th, and with Army Group C, encircled French forces behind the Maginot Line. With the French retreating all along the front, on June the 17th, the government sued for peace. In less than 6 weeks, Germany had conquered four countries and a quarter of a million square miles of territory. On June the 22nd, the French signed the armistice that confirmed Adolf Hitler as master of Western Europe. The campaign had succeeded beyond his wildest dreams. But even as his generals looked forward to their field marshal's batons, their estates, and the wealth of plunder that would be theirs, Hitler's own thoughts were elsewhere. He had won his empire, but he also faced a fundamental strategic problem. To sustain the German military machine, the Reich needed oil, raw materials, and foodstuffs, and neither Germany nor the newly conquered territories could provide them. Hitler worried that Germany was already dependent on huge imports from the Soviet Union, and there was no telling how long these would be forthcoming. Even more troubling, Russia had once again taken advantage of German commitments in the West. To the Soviet conquest of eastern Poland in September 1939, and the seizure of Finnish territory that winter, Stalin now added the Baltic states of Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia. In June 1940, they were declared part of the Soviet Union, threatening German trade in the Baltic. Hitler's reply was an agreement with the Finns that would allow German troops on Finnish soil. The next stirrings of Soviet ambition were felt in the south. Romania was ordered to hand over Bessarabia and northern Bukovina. And on June the 27th, these territories were occupied by the Red Army. Romania was Germany's main source of oil, and the Soviets now had strong forces massed within striking distance. Hitler's response was to deploy powerful formations in Poland, and later he would win a string of agreements, allowing him to send German troops to Romania, Hungary, and Bulgaria. While Germany and the Soviet Union jockeyed for advantage in the Balkans and the Baltic, in the West, there remained a thorn in Germany's side. Britain was still defiant. Her army had been driven from France, leaving nearly all its heavy weapons behind. But Winston Churchill, the new Prime Minister, was refusing to negotiate. Not only did he proclaim that Britain would fight to the end, but he also launched a diplomatic initiative to turn Russia against Germany. In fact, Stalin had no intention of being drawn into a war which could only benefit the capitalist West. The British overture was firmly rebuffed. By the time Adolf Hitler had returned to Berlin after his triumphant campaign in France, he had already made up his mind to attack and conquer the Soviet Union. From the beginning, Hitler had built the Nazi Party on a deep hatred of communists, Jews, and Slavs. And he was convinced that Soviet communism was a Jewish conspiracy. Now he had a unique opportunity to destroy his ideological and racial enemies. At the same time, he could win for Germany the resources that would secure the Reich for generations to come. Hitler was haunted by two great fears. The first was that the Soviet Union, already embarked on a massive armaments program, would soon be so well prepared for war that the chance of a successful German attack would vanish forever. The second was the prospect of an alliance between Russia, Britain, and the United States, an alliance which Germany's slender resources could never defeat. Hitler concluded that the Reich's only hope of survival lay in the complete destruction of the Soviet Union. However, it would have to be done within a year at the very most. On July the 31st, 1940, Hitler announced to his senior military commanders that he intended to attack Russia not later than the summer of 1941. The generals protested that with Britain still hostile, Germany was exposing itself to the danger of a war on two fronts. Hitler dismissed their fears. He had seen the Red Army's dismal performance in Finland, and now he predicted, "You have only to kick in the door, and the whole rotten structure will come crashing down." Since 1928, Joseph Stalin had kept his position of supreme power in the Soviet Union by the most devious and ruthless means. Everyone who might conceivably threaten his authority was killed. In 1937, he had turned his attention to the Soviet armed forces. In a relentless sweep, Stalin executed all 11 deputy commissars for defense, 3 out of 5 field marshals, 13 out of 15 army commanders, and tens of thousands of middle-ranking and junior officers. Many more were sent to labor camps. Stalin replaced the executed senior commanders with cronies from his Civil War days, however incompetent. And within a year, the Red Army was firmly under the dictator's personal control. In 1940, the army's humiliation at the hands of the Finns had persuaded Stalin that the Soviet armed forces had to be reformed. The incredible speed of Germany's victory over France only underlined the urgency of the task. However, with so many of Russia's most effective commanders gone, progress was slow and hesitant. Although Stalin was deeply worried about German intentions, he was sure that while Britain was still fighting, Hitler would never attack the Soviet Union. The German leader would apply pressure to get what he wanted, but unless he was provoked, Hitler would stop short of actual war. Surrounded by men who dared not question his judgment, Stalin would persist until the very end in believing that the German threat was no more than a gigantic bluff. The key to a German victory over Russia would be speed above all else. Hitler insisted that Soviet forces in the West would have to be defeated within 10 weeks of the start of the invasion. A complete German victory would have to be won within 17 weeks. The reason was not just the notorious Russian winter, but also the inescapable fact that there would only be enough fuel, ammunition, and supplies for a quick and decisive campaign. Time was everything. From the start, German planners had to take account of a major natural obstacle which lay in the path of any direct thrust into the Soviet Union. The Pripyat Marshes was a vast area of swamps and forests, 150 miles long and 300 miles deep. It was expected that the Soviet defenders would be in two main concentrations, divided by the marshes, with a reserve around Moscow. The German offensive, codenamed Operation Otto, would be launched by three army groups, two of them to the north of the marshes and one to the south. Army Group Center would have the most important task, a drive straight towards Moscow, the hub of the Soviet system. Army Group North would push towards Leningrad, an important arms production center. Army Group South would attack towards Kiev, from southern Poland and from Romania. After all three army groups had pushed deep into the interior, the northern and southern groups would swing inwards to support Army Group Center for the final advance on the Soviet capital. The threat to Moscow would draw in the remnants of the Red Army and ensure their total destruction. Although the Army High Command had developed its plan over four painstaking months, testing and refining it with war games, Adolf Hitler was far from satisfied. Haunted by the fate of Napoleon, who had taken Moscow but failed to destroy the Russian army, he insisted that the Soviet capital was irrelevant. In early December, at a stroke, Hitler changed the entire emphasis of the campaign. His new plan was named Operation Barborossa. Hitler insisted that the Red Army had to be destroyed west of a line linking the rivers Dnieper and Dvina. His plan was designed, above all else, to prevent the enemy from withdrawing into the interior. As before, Army Group North would strike towards Leningrad. Army Group Center would force a breakthrough towards Minsk and Smolensk. However, in the new plan, their main task would be to destroy the Red Army in the north. They would achieve this by two encirclement operations, one around Minsk and the second in the Baltic states. The Baltic offensive would culminate in the capture of Leningrad and give the Wehrmacht valuable ports to supply its offensive. Below the Pripyat Marshes, Army Group South would make a single thrust towards the Dnieper at Kiev and would drive southeast along the river to prevent a Russian withdrawal. The Soviets would be attacked from the rear and annihilated. Army Group South would then push east towards the industrial Donetsk Basin and the oil fields of the Caucasus. Only after their great flanking operations had destroyed the bulk of the Red Army would the invaders turn their attention to the capture of Moscow. After the destruction of the reserve Russian armies and the fall of the Soviet capital, the next stage would be the establishment of a German defensive line stretching from Archangel to the River Volga. The last remaining industrial areas east of the Volga and beyond the Ural Mountains would now be in easy reach of the German Air Force and would be bombed into the ground. Without an industrial base, the Russians would be unable to mount an effective resistance for the foreseeable future. Operation Barbarossa depended for its success on the performance of the armored formations which would spearhead every thrust. However, the men who led the panzer groups were already deeply unhappy with the plan. Heinz Guderian, the tactician who had done most to develop German armored warfare, pleaded for a bolder stroke. The panzers, stripped to their fighting core and supplied by parachute drop, should race deep into the Soviet Union, perhaps even to Moscow, completely paralyzing the Russian defense. Mopping up could be left to the infantry following on behind. Hitler and his senior commanders, nearly all infantry and artillery men by training, would have none of Guderian's plan. The panzers were to fight classic battles of encirclement, no deeper than a few hundred miles into the Soviet Union. In the early stages, the armor would even be controlled by infantry generals. The panzer leaders, Germany's greatest assets in its campaigns so far, would begin the most ambitious offensive in the Reich's history with their hands firmly tied. Since the start of the war in Europe, the Soviet Union had been building vast stockpiles of food, strategic metals, and oil. At the same time, an increasing proportion of Soviet industry was being located far to the east, in relative safety beyond the Urals. However, Stalin resolutely ignored advice to move the strategic stockpiles east as well. The disagreement was part of a larger dispute between Stalin and his military planners. Where should the forces defending the Soviet Union be deployed? On the western borders or deeper inside the Russian heartland? During the 1930s, the backbone of the Russian defense was the Stalin Line, a series of fortified areas. The most formidable stretches were in the north, those between the Pripyat Marshes and the Upper Dniester, and those guarding the approaches to key cities and towns near the frontier zone, Leningrad, Pskov, Smolensk, Kiev, Khorasan, and Odessa. The system was capable of causing immense problems for any invader, and it sheltered the main Red Army formations along with their supply depots and training areas. By 1941, Russian expansion in Poland, the Baltic, and Romania had left the defenses of the Stalin Line well to the east of the Soviet frontier. Stalin now insisted that the Red Army should move west, leaving its fortifications and supply dumps behind, and take up positions on the new borders. Stalin's insistence on a forward defense was strongly opposed by many Russian commanders. They feared that in the event of a German attack, they would be outflanked all too quickly. There was little time to build new defenses, and the army's lines of communication to its base areas were now dangerously stretched. Nor were there adequate mobile forces well behind the borders to counter-attack a German breakthrough. Stalin, however, had his own agenda. He had hopes that he might yet mount another invasion of Finland or snatch more territory in the Balkans. Meanwhile, the Red Army was expected to mount a defense of the Soviet Union from little more than an incomplete system of trenches. Walter von Brauchitsch was appointed by Hitler commander-in-chief of the German army in 1938. A competent, but by no means outstanding soldier, he was chosen more for his pliability than for his professional qualities. At the same time, the once powerful post of commander-in-chief was downgraded, becoming merely an instrument for carrying out Hitler's orders. Although Brauchitsch was in charge of operational matters during the Polish and Western campaigns, he had no real say in the way the war as a whole was fought. On one occasion, Brauchitsch did try to stand up to Hitler. During the preparation of the French campaign, he criticized the logistical side of the plan, and for his pains, he was severely reprimanded. To add to the indignity, Hitler refused to let him resign. When Operation Barbarossa was being drawn up, Brauchitsch voiced doubts that the Luftwaffe could fight both Britain and Russia at once. Hitler instantly browbeat him into submission, and when Brauchitsch supported a direct thrust at Moscow, he was told that only ossified brains could think of such an idea. Humiliated, it was the last attempt Brauchitsch made to challenge Hitler's plan or to defend the professional independence of the German army. Georgi Zhukov had joined the Russian army during the Great War and the Red Army in 1918, rising quickly through the ranks. A ruthless and hard-driving commander, utterly intolerant of weaknesses in his subordinates, Zhukov made his reputation during the Russian-Japanese War in Mongolia in 1939. There, he won his victories by insisting on rigid cooperation between artillery, tanks, and infantry, and by a total disregard for casualties. In January 1941, Zhukov had taken part in elaborate war games, supervised by the defense commissar, Marshal Timoshenko. Zhukov had commanded the forces representing the Germans and had succeeded in wiping out the Russian defenders on the borders and penetrating deep into Soviet territory. Afterwards, Stalin fired the chief of the general staff and Zhukov was given his job. Huh? Like virtually all Soviet commanders, Zhukov subscribed to the belief that the best form of defense was attack, and that to do this, room was needed for maneuver. He disagreed profoundly with Stalin's plan for a forward defense of the western frontiers and wanted to hold back strong formations in the interior. Although Zhukov would go on to be one of the few Red Army commanders willing to argue openly with the dictator, this time he did not dare press his case too hard. Following his decision to invade Russia, Hitler had ordered a major expansion in the German army. By the time of Operation Barbarossa, it would be almost 4 million strong, with over 200 divisions. However, there would be no corresponding increase in quality. At Hitler's insistence, the number of panzer divisions had been doubled from 10 to 20. Typically, the order had been made without considering where the extra tanks were to come from. As a result, the number of machines in each division fell by more than a third, down to an average of 160 tanks. Nor were there enough of the newer, heavier models to compensate. More than half the machines available for Barbarossa would be Mark 1s and 2s and Czech 38s, light tanks never meant to be part of the panzer divisions. There was also a shortage of supporting vehicles. Each armored division needed almost 3,000 trucks to carry infantry, fuel, and other supplies. Newly formed motorized infantry divisions also needed trucks, and Hitler had made no provision for increased production. Many units were instead equipped with captured vehicles, mostly French, much less robust than German types. There was also a 50% shortfall in stocks of tires. In fact, so far was the German army from being a mechanized fighting force that the infantry divisions would haul their supplies into the Soviet Union using 625,000 horses. In Poland and the West, the Luftwaffe had played a key role in supporting ground operations. German aircraft had provided an umbrella for the infantry, had disrupted enemy communications, and had hammered troop concentrations and fortified positions. This time, it was by no means certain that the Air Force could perform anything like as well. In the Battle of Britain, the Luftwaffe had been dreadfully mauled, and it had no more aircraft for the Russian campaign than it had deployed against France in 1940. Meantime, one third of its available machines were desperately in need of service or repair. The Mark III Panzer had been designed in 1937 as the mainstay of the German armored divisions. In the Battle of France, the Mark III had encountered Allied tanks with very heavy armor, and its 37mm gun proved nowhere near powerful enough to cope. After the 1940 battles, Hitler ordered the Mark III fitted with a more powerful 50mm L60 high-velocity gun. However, because of supply problems and the confusion which typically arose when attempts were made to keep up with the Führer's personal interventions, a different gun was actually fitted. The 50mm L42 had a lower muzzle velocity than the L60, and in the Soviet Union, it would prove ineffective against the thick, sloping armor of the latest Soviet tanks. For Operation Barborossa, German fighter groups were equipped with the Messerschmitt 109, a superb aircraft, superior to any current Soviet fighter. The 109F, which reached the squadrons in the spring of 1941, was a substantial improvement on its predecessor. Its fuselage was aerodynamically cleaner, and its wingspan had been slightly increased, giving a better performance at all altitudes. The airframe was also strengthened to exploit the extra power offered by new versions of the DB601 engine. Fast, maneuverable, and a delight to fly, the 109F was armed with a single cannon firing through the spinner and two machine guns on the nose. Because pilots were unhappy with the 15mm cannon fitted to early Fs, later versions mounted a far more destructive 20mm weapon. The PAK-36 anti-tank gun had entered service with the German army in 1938. In the Battle of France, the 37mm weapon had been far from adequate against the heavy armor of many French and British tanks. Its shot could penetrate 50mm of plate at 500 meters, but only in ideal conditions, with the projectile hitting the armor at right angles. In 1940, a more powerful version of the gun was introduced. The 50mm PAK-38 could penetrate 80mm of armor at 500 meters, although again, only under perfect conditions. In Russia, of the 72 anti-tank guns in each infantry division, less than one-tenth would be PAK-38s. The rest would be the much less effective 37mm weapon. The stunning victories of the previous 2 years had left the German soldier utterly confident of the invincibility of the Wehrmacht. In training, tactics, and leadership in the field, the German army had been shown to be without equal. By 1941, it was even better than before. Training had been improved in the light of battlefield experience, and the relations between the men and their officers, always good, had been tempered in combat to a new level of confidence and trust. As for the officers themselves, although they were as tactically skilled and as disciplined as at any time in the history of the German army, many had little else in common with their forebears. Under Hitler, the influence of the traditional military class had declined, and rearmament had increased the size of the officer corps very quickly. A large number of newly commissioned men were committed Nazis, and even amongst the rest, there was a gradual acceptance of many Nazi beliefs. The conviction that Russians were an inferior race and a hatred for Jews was by now widespread amongst German officers. When Hitler demanded that in Russia ruthless measures must be taken against Bolshevists, partisans and Jews, there was little protest from German commanders at any level.
Parteitag der Bewegung geht zu Ende. Was
In the Soviet Union, the German army would descend to levels of barbarism that the officer of only a generation before would have found unthinkable. Although the Red Army could field 4.5 million men and 23,000 tanks, more armor than the rest of the world put together, its equipment was mostly obsolete, its doctrines were confused, and its operational effectiveness was abysmally poor. Finland, and now the German victories in France, had shocked the army into frantic efforts to reform itself. But the task was a mammoth one. A top priority was rebuilding the large-scale mechanized corps which Stalin had disbanded in 1939. Their tanks had been scattered amongst the infantry divisions, and now they had to be equipped, manned, and trained from scratch. By the spring of 1941, the reorganization of the Soviet armed forces was still far from complete. Only 30% of Russian tanks were fully serviceable. The new mechanized corps had only half the machines they had been promised, lacked motorized support vehicles, and had no tracked supply or infantry vehicles at all. Motor transport was short throughout the Red Army, as were spare parts. Ammunition supplies were a problem for the artillery, for the newer tanks, and for the anti-tank guns. There was also a desperate lack of ancillary equipment, particularly radios. And in nearly all Russian armored formations, only the tank of the unit commander would be equipped with wireless. Like the rest of the Red Army, the Air Force was burdened with huge numbers of obsolete machines, and it too suffered from poor maintenance and equipment shortages. The Air Force's problems would be compounded by the fact that of 1,000 airfields in the West, only 200 were operationally serviceable. The BT series of fast tanks was based on a revolutionary suspension system developed in America and licensed to the Russians in the early 1930s. The machines had a superb cross-country performance and were capable of almost 50 miles per hour. Although it was armed with a 45mm gun, almost as good as the best of its German counterparts, the BT-7 was lightly armored and could easily be destroyed by any German tank or anti-tank gun. BT-7s made up the bulk of Red Army medium tank forces on the eve of the German invasion. The T-34 was the best all-round tank design of the Second World War and entered service with the Red Army in the summer of 1940. Its excellent suspension had been developed from the BT-7, and with its wide tracks and powerful diesel engine, it was capable of traversing ground that would be impossible to any other tank of its weight. The T-34's armor was thick and well sloped to deflect anti-tank rounds. The tank was armed with a high-velocity 75mm gun, better than any other tank gun in the world. With such a powerful weapon, the T-34 could engage and destroy an enemy at long range with little risk to itself. In the 12 months up to the German invasion, the Soviet Union produced almost 1,200 T-34s. and in spite of initial teething troubles, they would have an effect on the course of the battle, out of all proportion to their numbers. Petlyakov PE-2 entered frontline service with the Soviet Air Force in late 1940. Although designed as a high-altitude fighter, it was as a light bomber that the aircraft became one of the most useful weapons in the Russian armory. A popular aircraft with the men who flew it, the PE-2 was easy to handle, stable in a dive, and capable of very accurate bombing. It was also faster than the German 109E fighter, although when it encountered the later 109F, it had to depend for survival on its high altitude capability, and bombing accuracy suffered as a result. The PE-2 would prove one of the most successful aircraft of its type in any Allied air force, and it would be updated throughout the war. Although only 458 were in service at the start of Operation Barbarossa, before the battle was over, the aircraft would take a very heavy toll of German armor and supply columns. Before Stalin's purge, the Red Army had been an innovative and highly professional force. The loss of a whole generation of highly trained men had left it desperately lacking skilled commanders of all ranks. There was a wave of early promotions, and thousands of officers suddenly held commands well beyond their abilities. Of those leading regiments, barely more than 10% had been trained above the level of junior lieutenant. A massive training program was mounted, particularly aimed at infantry officers, but there was little time. The situation was so serious that 4,000 ex-commanders were released from labor camps or brought back from disgrace. The rapid expansion of the Russian Air Force posed even greater training problems than those faced by the army. Pilots took a great deal of time to produce, and the flying schools were overburdened and ill-equipped. There was also a shortage of combat-experienced instructors. Many Russian pilots would fight the veterans of the Luftwaffe with only 15 hours flying time behind them, and even amongst the better trained, tactical skills were extremely poor. In Directive 21, Hitler's order for the attack on Russia, he had given a date of May the 15th, by which time all preparations must be complete. By the beginning of the month, nearly 80 German divisions were already in place, their movements covered by an elaborate campaign of deception and disinformation. Dozens of forward airfields had been built in secret, and vast quantities of fuel, stores, and ammunition stockpiled close to the jumping-off areas. However, there were already signs that Hitler's timetable was falling to pieces. The winter of 1940 had been exceptionally long and harsh, and the eastern frontier regions were still a quagmire. Neither had the army yet received anything like the number of trucks it needed. With a postponement looking ever more likely, events in the south soon made it inescapable. In October 1940, Greece had been invaded by the Italians, but the Greeks had succeeded in driving them back to Albania. The British sent an expeditionary force to help Greece, suddenly posing a grave threat to Germany's Romanian oil supplies. Adolf Hitler was furious at the British intervention and ordered the invasion and occupation of Greece. The Greek campaign was intended to be a simple operation, and Hitler thought he could count on the support of Yugoslavia. However, on March the 27th, an anti-German faction, encouraged by British agents, mounted a coup and deposed the Yugoslav government. Hitler was forced to improvise. On April the 6th, German troops, led by powerful panzer formations, swept into both Yugoslavia and Greece. Until the armored units could be retrieved from the Balkans, the invasion of the Soviet Union would have to wait. The new date for Operation Barbarossa was June the 22nd. The defeat of Yugoslavia took the Germans only 12 days. It was a savage campaign in which the capital, Belgrade, was bombed into rubble, killing 17,000 civilians. Two more weeks and Greece was also overrun. By the end of April, the British Expeditionary Force had been evacuated by sea, leaving thousands of its men prisoners and abandoning most of its heavy equipment. As soon as the Balkan campaign was over, German armored forces and headquarters units began to trickle northwards to join the massive forces already assembling in Romania, Poland, and East Prussia. Meanwhile, reconnaissance units of the Luftwaffe worked at a frantic pace. Every available hour of daylight was used to plot Russian troop concentrations, supply dumps, headquarters and airfields, and mark them down for destruction. For the invasion of Russia, fully 75% of the entire German army, more than 3 million men, was assembled into three massive army groups. The armored fists of the attack deployed more than 3,500 tanks, and the ground forces were supported by 2,500 aircraft. It was an enormous effort, and there was no possibility that it could be completely hidden from the Russians. However, Adolf Hitler had a ready explanation for Stalin. With breathtaking audacity, he sent a message telling him that he had moved his troops to Poland to protect them from British bombers. By the beginning of June, the infantry divisions were in place close to the Soviet frontiers. Soon after, the motorized units and armored divisions, the spearheads of the assault, began to edge nearer to their jumping-off positions. Army Group North was concentrated in East Prussia. Commanded by Field Marshal Wilhelm von Leib, Army Group North had 18th and 16th armies. Von Leib's armored spearhead was General Hoeppner's Panzer Group 4. The infantry armies would field 20 divisions, and the Panzer Group, 3 armored and 3 motorized infantry divisions. The Finnish, Karelian, and Southeastern armies would join the battle later, in loose cooperation with Army Group North. For air support, von Leib could call on the 1st Air Fleet. Army Group Center was deployed in Poland. Commanded by Field Marshal Fedor von Bock, Army Group Center had 9th and 4th armies. Its armored forces were Hoth's Panzer Group 3 and Guderian's Panzer Group 2. The two infantry armies fielded 33 divisions, and the panzer groups 9 armored, 6 motorized, and a cavalry division. Army Group Center could call on 2nd Air Fleet for support. Army Group South was deployed in southern Poland and Romania. Commanded by Field Marshal Gerd von Rundstedt, Army Group South had 6th and 17th armies in Poland and 11th Army in Romania. Its armored force was Kleist's Panzer Group 1. The infantry armies had 33 divisions, and the Panzer Group 5 armored and 3 motorized divisions. Supporting von Rundstedt would be 2 Romanian armies, the 3rd and 4th, 1 Hungarian and 1 Slovakian infantry corps, and an Italian motorized corps. The 4th Air Fleet would support ground operations. In the last fortnight before the German invasion, the pace of Soviet preparations for war accelerated dramatically. Although Stalin was still refusing to believe that the German danger was real, his commanders were forcing through precautionary measures wherever they could. 793,000 reservists were called up for training, so at least some frontline units could be brought up to strength. The building of fortifications on the frontiers was stepped up, although to do so often meant stripping army divisions of transport, tractors, and men. Anti-aircraft defenses were also strengthened, although their crews were still under the strictest instructions not to open fire on German aircraft. Of total Soviet strength, 2,900,000 were deployed on the western frontiers, along with 15,000 tanks and 9,000 aircraft. More divisions were on their way. However, by the time of the German invasion, a full Soviet mobilization would not even have begun. The Western Soviet Union was divided into 4 military areas: the Baltic, Western, Kiev, and Odessa districts. After the start of the battle, these were reorganized and renamed fronts. The Northwest Front was commanded by Colonel General Fyodor Kuznetsov. Kuznetsov fielded 8th and 11th armies, with 27th Army in its second echelon. Altogether, Northwest Front had 28 rifle, 4 tank, and 2 motorized divisions. The West Front was commanded by General Dmitry Pavlov. West Front deployed 3rd, 10th, and 4th armies, with 13th as a supreme command reserve. Altogether, 25 rifle and cavalry divisions, 13 tank and 7 motorized divisions. The Southwest Front was in the Ukraine and was commanded by Colonel General Mikhail Kirponos. Kirponos had 5th, 6th, 26th and 12th armies, with 27 rifle and cavalry divisions, 12 tank and 6 motorized divisions. Bordering the Black Sea was the South Front, commanded by General Ivan Tulenev. Tulenev had 9th and later 18th armies, with 17 rifle and cavalry divisions, 6 tank divisions, and 3 motorized divisions. As well as the armies in place with the 4 Soviet fronts, another 4 armies, the 22nd, 19th, 21st, and 16th, a total of 114 divisions, were already under orders to move west. These would arrive after the start of the battle. Each of the fronts also had its own aviation component of bombers and fighters for support of ground operations. Starting at 3:15 on the morning of Sunday, June the 22nd, 1941, German guns opened up on one sector of the Soviet frontier after another. The salvos were carefully targeted. Communication centers, fuel and ammunition dumps, border defenses and barrack accommodation were all pounded without mercy. At hundreds of border posts, Soviet guards were killed without warning by specially trained assault troops who secured the bridges and crossing points. Far behind the beleaguered Soviet frontier units, German warplanes had appeared with the dawn. The first waves concentrated their destructive power on Red Army airfields. Most Russian aircraft were caught helpless on the ground. On the first day alone, the Luftwaffe would destroy more than 1,400 Russian planes. As the hail of high explosives rained on the Soviet frontier defenses and rear areas, Russian commanders frantically tried to interpret their instructions from Moscow. They had been warned not to react to provocations, but no one had told them how to tell a provocation from a full-scale attack. In a welter of confusion, orders were given and then countermanded. Many units received no orders at all. Key communication centers were out of action, bombed, or the victims of nationalist saboteurs trained by the Germans. By 6 a.m., the whole frontier zone from East Prussia to the Carpathians was engulfed in one gigantic battle. However, it was in the center, in Belorussia, where half of all Germany's mechanized units were in action, that the most crucial battles of the opening phase were about to take place. Opposite the German Army Group Center were 4 Soviet armies. The 10th, 3rd, and 4th of the West Front and the 11th Army of the Northwest Front. The Russians occupied a salient which jutted into German territory, its center at Bialystok. Beyond Bialystok was Minsk, a key rail junction and guardian of the main highway to Moscow. To the north, Panzer Group III smashed through at the junction between the two Soviet fronts and crossed the River Niemen. Panzer Group II forced the River Bug, and by the second day had penetrated 40 miles into Soviet territory. With the panzers racing forward on the outside, 4th and 9th Infantry Armies cut into the salient with pincer movements, squeezing between them the Russian armies around Bialystok. The panzers' objective was to meet at Minsk and prevent any Russian withdrawal. As the German spearhead sliced through the Soviet frontier armies, Moscow failed completely to grasp the dimensions of the catastrophe which had befallen Russia. On the evening of the first day, the defense commissar, Marshal Timoshenko, had ordered all three Soviet fronts to mount a general counteroffensive and sweep the enemy from Soviet territory. Timoshenko's order was a fantasy. The Soviet reserve was not yet fully mobilized, and there was no operational plan. All General Pavlov, commander of the key West Front, could do was turn for inspiration to war games played the previous January. With control and communications in the frontline areas almost completely broken down, with fuel and ammunition dumps burning, and the German Air Force in control of the skies, the attacks were doomed from the start. On June the 27th, 5 days after the invasion, the armored jaws of Guderian's Panzer Group II and Hoth's Panzer Group III closed near Minsk. 200 miles into the Soviet Union and a third of the way to Moscow. It was a stunning achievement. In the vast pocket that had been created around Bialystok and Minsk, 32 Soviet infantry and 8 tank divisions were facing annihilation. While Army Group Center was smashing its way into the Soviet West Front, Army Group North had thrown its 600 tanks at the junction of the Soviet 8th and 11th Armies of the Northwest Front. The German spearheads were the 41st and 56th Panzer Corps of Panzer Group IV. Their objectives were to cross the rivers Niemen and Dvina, the most difficult natural obstacles in front of Army Group North. On the first day of the attack, the armored spearheads crossed the Niemen and penetrated 50 miles. Near Rasenie, on the second day, 41st Panzer was counterattacked by 300 tanks of the Soviet 12th and 3rd Mechanized Corps. It took 4 days for the Germans to encircle and destroy the Russian force. Meanwhile, 56th Panzer Corps dashed for the River Dvina and, in a remarkable coup, seized bridges at Dvinsk intact. After the seizure of the Dvina bridges and the fall of Dvinsk, the leading formations of 56th Panzer Corps furiously set about enlarging the bridgehead. A priceless opportunity now offered itself. An immediate drive forwards would make it almost impossible for the Soviets to defend Leningrad. However, it was not to be. Orders, received with disbelief by the tankmen, were to wait for the infantry to arrive. In the end, the wait would last almost a week. While German operations in the north and in the center had produced dramatic advances, in the south, the invasion forces attacked a sector whose commanders had woken up quickly to the German threat, and whose tank forces vastly outnumbered the panzers. From the start, the invaders faced a determined resistance. On the German side, the left wing of Army Group South was made up of the 17th and 6th Armies, along with one panzer group, the 1st. Opposite stood the Soviet 5th, 6th, and 26th Armies. While German infantry struck at the junctions between Russian formations, Panzer Group 1 drove its armored spearhead of 600 tanks towards the town of Brody. On June the 26th, five Soviet mechanized corps, with over 1,000 tanks, mounted massive counterattacks from north and south. The aim was to cut through the flanks of Panzer Group 1 and meet near Dubno. The battle between Panzer Group 1 and the massed armor of the Soviet Southwestern Front was one of the fiercest of the whole invasion, lasting a full 4 days. The Russians fought furiously, and crews of German tanks and anti-tank guns found to their horror that the new Soviet T-34s and heavy KVs were almost immune to their weapons. However, the tanks were seldom handled well or concentrated into powerful groups. They could be isolated, and after they had been immobilized by blowing off their tracks, they could be destroyed at close quarters. Meanwhile, the Luftwaffe was ranging freely over the battlefield, smashing Russian armor wherever it was found. The Soviet armored pincers failed to meet at Dubno. Although Panzer Group 1 took a severe battering in the battles around Dubno, it survived the confrontation, still capable of operations. The Soviets did not. The last substantial tank forces in the south had been used up, consumed in the inferno. By the end of the first week of Operation Barborossa, all three German army groups had won major battles on the frontiers and had shattered every counterattack which had been thrown at them. The German High Command was jubilant, and there was already talk of reaching Moscow within a fortnight. Hitler told his followers, "To all intents and purposes, the Russians have lost the war." The euphoria would last barely a week. Events would occur on the Central Front that changed Hitler's mood from exuberance to extreme anxiety. To the astonishment of German soldiers, the encircled Russian forces in the pockets at Minsk and Bialystok were fighting on, even when their situation was plainly hopeless. Mopping up was taking far too long and costing too many German casualties. The German infantry, with no motor transport, had been slow to seal the encirclements, and many Russians were escaping the net, the very thing that Hitler had been most anxious to avoid. Although 290,000 Russian prisoners were marched westwards, and 1,500 guns and 2,500 tanks were destroyed or captured, a quarter of a million Russian soldiers would evade the trap or fight their way back to Soviet lines. As Hitler and his commanders realized that the victories at Bialystok and Minsk had been only partial, there were bitter recriminations. Hitler blamed the leaders of Army Group Center, particularly the Panzer generals, for leaving gaps in the ring. The Panzer leaders, for their part, were deeply frustrated. For almost a week, their advance east had been stopped while they closed the pocket and waited for the infantry to catch up. They feared that if the momentum of the armored offensive was lost, further east, Russian resistance would stiffen behind the rivers Dnieper and Dvina. On July the 3rd, Joseph Stalin made his first broadcast to the Soviet people since the start of the German invasion. Laying aside the cloak of communist ideology, he appealed for a patriotic war. There would be no surrender, and everything that could be of use to the invader was to be destroyed in his path. Behind the lines, partisan bands were to be formed, and meantime, the strategy was to defend the Soviet Union as far to the west as possible, where most of its population and its industries were based. Provision was being made to dismantle key factories which lay in the path of the invader and ship them east, along with their skilled workers. But it would all take time. Terrified that the Soviet state faced complete collapse, Stalin quickly introduced the harshest penalties for those accused of being panic-mongers, cowards, or incompetents. In the following weeks, Pavlov, the commander of West Front, was executed, along with members of his staff. As for lesser commanders, many who had broken out of encirclements were also shot for not having resisted to the end. Meanwhile, on the German side of the lines, captured Red Army soldiers thought to be communists, commissars, or Jews were handed over by the army to SS special action groups for immediate execution. In the months to come, many Red Army units would fight to the bitter end because their leaders dared neither surrender nor retreat. On the same day as Stalin called for a great patriotic war, the Panzer leaders of Army Group Center at last got the go-ahead to resume their drive east. The main Panzer forces had been static for almost a week, and now, on the very day the general offensive was resumed, the weather broke. A sudden rainstorm, typical of early July, turned the sandy tracks into streaming rivers of mud. The advancing armored divisions found themselves immobile for hours at a time. All the while, the Russian defense became more determined. Many bridges were blown, and for the first time, mines were laid to slow the German advance, an easy task with the convoys confined to the very few roads. The delays gave the Soviets time to organize for a massive armored counterblow. The ultimate objective for Army Group Center was the city of Smolensk, which commanded the road to Moscow. Facing the Germans along the rivers Dnieper and Dvina were stretches of the old Stalin Line fortifications. The defenders were 13th Army of the West Front and the 22nd, 20th and 21st Armies of the Supreme Command Reserve. Another army, the 19th, was forming up at Vitebsk, while the 16th was arriving at Smolensk. It was the threat in the north from Panzer Group III's 39th Panzer Corps that most worried the Russians. On July the 6th, 20th Army's 7th and 5th Mechanized Corps launched an attack with 700 tanks. The Germans had overwhelming air support, and in a three-day battle, the two Soviet mechanized corps were virtually wiped out. Meanwhile, 20th Panzer Division won a bridgehead on the eastern bank of the Dvina and threatened Vitebsk. To the south, away from the main crossings, Panzer Group II launched surprise attacks, forcing the River Dnieper. The 13th Army was pushed back, losing five divisions. As both German panzer groups drove east, three Soviet armies faced the prospect of encirclement around Smolensk. South of Smolensk, Guderian's 2nd Panzer Group advanced at speed, and its 29th Motorized Infantry Division took the city on July the 16th. However, to the north, Hoth's 3rd Panzer was moving much more slowly. The terrain was swampy, the rain was still a problem, and the Russians were fighting desperately to escape the trap that was developing. On July the 18th, the great armored pincers of the two panzer groups came within 10 miles of closing. But the jaws would not finally snap shut for another 8 days. In the end, although 300,000 Russians were captured, more than 200,000 would break out to stand between the Germans and Moscow. By now, nearly 4 weeks into the campaign, it was obvious to German commanders and to Adolf Hitler himself that the number of divisions the Red Army could field had been grossly underestimated. There was no sign that the Soviet Union was about to collapse. In fact, there were worrying threats to the flanks of Army Group Center. On August the 4th, Adolf Hitler flew to Army Group Center's headquarters at Borisov, east of Minsk. By now, he had lost faith in battles of encirclement and had begun to believe that he could best defeat the Soviet Union by inflicting severe economic damage. That meant making better progress in the south to cut off Russia's oil, and in the north, the speedy capture of Leningrad. He had come to Minsk to tell the commander of Army Group Center, Field Marshal von Bock, that his drive east towards Moscow was to be stopped, and his tanks were to be sent to Leningrad and the Ukraine. Hitler's plan involved sending the armor on 300-mile detours. The Panzer generals, Guderian and Hoth, were appalled. Moscow was only 200 miles from the front, and most of the Red Army was deployed around the city. The generals were certain that only an attack there gave any chance of winning the war outright. However, Hitler was adamant, and a final desperate appeal by the army commander-in-chief, von Brauchitsch, was rejected out of hand. Hitler complained that his generals knew nothing of the economic aspects of war. The panzers were to be diverted, and that was final. By mid-July, below the Pripyat Marshes, the 6th Army of Army Group South, along with Panzer Group 1, had reached to within a few miles of Kiev. The armor had then swung south, while the advance from Romania, with the Romanian 3rd Army and the German 11th and 17th, pushed east. Three Soviet armies were squeezed into a pocket near Uman. As the pocket was eliminated, the tanks turned north and crossed the Dnieper. Meanwhile, Guderian's Panzer Group 2 had driven south and crossed the River Desna, with 2nd Army on its right. The two panzer groups now threatened to trap four Soviet armies and parts of two more against the great bend of the River Dnieper. For its final thrust at Leningrad, 4th Panzer Group of Army Group North had, on Hitler's orders, been reinforced by tanks from Army Group Center. On August the 8th, the panzers broke through Soviet defenses, and while 16th Army attacked to the northeast, 18th Army cleared Estonia and advanced around Lake Peipus. By the end of August, Panzer Group 4 and 18th Army had penetrated to within 30 miles of Leningrad. Meanwhile, the Finns had pushed southeast on both sides of Lake Ladoga, reaching the old Finnish-Soviet frontiers. On September the 9th, Army Group North began a final push on Leningrad. Within 2 days, German soldiers were on the heights only 7 miles from the city, and artillery was pounding the inhabitants relentlessly. Hitler's latest orders were that Leningrad should not be stormed. The advance had severed all of its road and rail links to the rest of the Soviet Union, and the city was now to be bombed, shelled, and starved into submission. The Führer had changed the priorities of the campaign yet again. Leningrad could wait. Army Group North's tanks were to be sent to the center for an all-out drive on Moscow. It was the Soviet West Front, launching furious counterattacks with its ground and air forces, which had drawn Hitler's restless attention to the Moscow sector. The problem was that Army Group Center was in no position to launch an immediate offensive. It was only 13 days since most of the group's tanks had been sent on their marathon drives to the north and south. These operations, particularly the one around Kiev, had to be finished before Operation Typhoon, the assault on Moscow, could begin. The encirclement of Soviet forces in the south was achieved on September the 16th, when Kleist's Panzer Group 1 and Guderian's 24th Corps met at Lokvitsa, 120 miles behind Kiev. For the Russians, a disaster of staggering dimensions now unfolded. The encircled Russian armies at Kiev did not give up easily. A savage battle in which the Soviets were hammered by artillery, tanks, and aircraft had to be fought before the pocket was reduced. In the end, after 10 days of carnage, the Germans claimed 600,000 Red Army soldiers captured. No one knew how many had been killed in what Hitler called the greatest battle in history. After Kiev, for the first time since the invasion, the Red Army no longer outnumbered the Germans, and there were no more reserves. To defend Moscow, Stalin could field 800,000 men in 83 divisions, but no more than 25 of those divisions were fully effective, and there was a desperate shortage of armor and aircraft. On the German side, there were 2 million men in 70 divisions. Almost one-third of the divisions were mechanized, the highest proportion of mechanized units to infantry in any German attack of the war so far. Operation Typhoon, the drive on Moscow, began on October the 2nd. In front of Army Group Center were the Soviet West and Bryansk fronts. There was also a series of elaborate defense lines, up to 250 miles long, the first centered on Vyazma and the others on Mozhaisk. The first blow took the Soviets completely by surprise. Guderian's 2nd Panzer Army, returning from the Kiev battle, took Orel, a vital road junction 75 miles behind the 1st Russian defense line. 3 days later, the panzers pushed on Bryansk, another communication center, while 2nd Army attacked from the west. 3 Russian armies were trapped. To the north, 3rd and 4th Panzer armies threw their pincers around Vyazma, trapping another 5 Soviet armies. Moscow's first line of defense had been shattered in the opening blows, and the door to Moscow had been burst open. It was Stalin's insistence on manning defensive lines to the very end that made the situation at Bryansk and Vyazma so catastrophic. The pockets yielded 663,000 Russian prisoners, bringing the tally since the start of the invasion to 3 million. Once again, the German High Command allowed itself to believe that the war in the East was won. This time, they were certain their belief was justified. On the Russian side, only 90,000 men and a handful of tanks were left on the last defense line in front of Moscow. In desperation, Stalin summoned General Zhukov, who had been organizing the defense of Leningrad, and gave him the job of saving the capital. Weeks before, Zhukov had resigned as chief of the general staff after a disagreement with the dictator. But now, Stalin chose to forget their differences. By this time, the situation outside Moscow was critical. On October the 13th, 4th Infantry Army penetrated the last Soviet defense line at Kaluga. At the same time, to the north, 3rd Panzer penetrated to within 90 miles of the capital and looked set to break into the Soviet rear. For the Russians, serious as the situation was on the flanks, in the center, there was mortal danger. There, 10th Panzer Division and the SS Das Reich Motorized Division had beaten off a furious counterattack at Borodino. They were now driving up the Smolensk to Moscow highway, advancing on Mozhaisk, the key to the central sector of the Moscow defense line, and only 60 miles from the city. With the German armies on the threshold of the capital, there was panic in Moscow. Martial law was declared. Government departments and embassies were evacuated. And there was a frantic effort to build last-ditch defenses in and around the city. Although the citizens of Moscow expected little mercy from the Germans, in fact, none knew the savage reality of Hitler's plans for the Soviet capital. The German armies had been instructed not to accept its surrender. Its inhabitants might be allowed to flee, but the city was to be obliterated from the face of the earth. In its place was to be built a gigantic reservoir. Almost from the beginning of Operation Typhoon, the weather had deteriorated steadily. The German advance, first in the south and then in the center, had gradually slowed as the season of rain and sleet had begun. Under the weight of traffic, the three roads on which the whole offensive depended for its supplies were reduced to quagmires. As the rain and snow persisted into a third week, the supply system broke down completely. Eventually, only tracked vehicles could move at all, and their fuel consumption soared while engines rapidly wore out. Meantime, the troops were living in appalling conditions, permanently wet, cold, and utterly exhausted. The advance slowed to as little as 2 miles a day. On October the 31st, the German Army High Command ordered a halt in Operation Typhoon. For General Zhukov, the pause was of priceless benefit. Although his forces were desperately weak, down to 190 working tanks, fresh formations were being created at great speed, and in little over a month, 11 new armies would be raised. Although some of the new formations were made up of barely trained conscripts, 30 divisions would be well-equipped and immensely tough Siberian troops. These had been freed from the eastern frontiers as Soviet intelligence assured Stalin there was no longer a threat from the Japanese. With the Siberians would come 1,000 tanks and 1,000 aircraft. On November the 7th, in a defiant gesture of normality, the annual Revolution Day parade was held in Moscow. The night before, the first severe frosts had hardened the ground. Only 50 miles from the city, the German armored columns were once more capable of movement. The last great effort to capture Moscow began on November the 15th. In increasingly heavy falls of snow, and with temperatures sinking ominously, the Germans threw themselves at the Soviet defenses. For their part, the Russians, on Zhukov's orders, launched a series of spoiling attacks. Little quarter was given on either side. Both attacking and defending troops knew that this could be a war-winning battle. Facing the German advance on Moscow were three Soviet fronts: Kalinin, west, and southwest. However, it was the six mostly understrength armies of General Zhukov's West Front that would bear the main weight of the assault. The German intention was that 3rd and 4th Panzer armies would cross the Volga Canal and envelop Moscow from the northeast. 2nd Panzer Army would first take Tula, then strike behind Moscow from the southeast to close with the northern pincer. As the Russians reacted and moved to the flanks, 4th Infantry Army would smash in the center. In 2 weeks of desperate fighting, in ever more arduous and exhausting conditions, the battle in the north slowly but remorselessly crept towards the Russian capital. However, in the south, against all the odds, Guderian's 2nd Panzer Army was being blocked. At Tula, the Soviet 50th Army, in spite of being almost surrounded, could not be dislodged. Then came a stunning blow for the Germans. At Kashira, on November the 27th, a savage attack by well-equipped Siberian infantry, T-34s, and new Katyusha rocket launchers inflicted a severe and shocking defeat on Guderian's forces. While Guderian's attack was being blocked, then broken to the north, after 10 days of bitter and continuous fighting, 4th Panzer succeeded in crossing the Volga Canal within 20 miles of Moscow and beginning the encirclement of the capital. On December the 2nd, a forward patrol penetrated to within 15 miles of the Kremlin. Hitler and his senior commanders were convinced that one last gargantuan effort would see the final collapse of Russian resistance. It would all depend on the last battalion. On December the 2nd, the first blizzards of winter swept across the German armies facing Moscow. The war in the east was supposed to have been long since won, and the Wehrmacht had never been equipped for conditions like these. At night, the temperature would soon plummet to as low as minus 40 degrees Fahrenheit. Frostbite and disease had already begun to cause as many German casualties as the endless Russian counterattacks. Dead and wounded had reached 155,000 in 3 weeks. And the strength of the infantry divisions had fallen to 50%. Meanwhile, the bitter cold caused serious problems for weapons and vehicles. Guns failed as their recoil systems froze, and engines had to be run every 4 hours, devouring fuel that was already in desperately short supply. Most disturbing of all for men who had always been able to count on protection from the air, conditions all too often grounded the Luftwaffe, while the Red Air Force seemed to grow more active as each day passed. On December the 1st, in the center, the German Fourth Army had launched a final massive effort to smash what defenses remained in front of Moscow. Everything depended on the Russians having no reserves. However, for weeks, Zhukov had been denied reinforcements, as Stalin had held back increasingly powerful reserve formations, including the bulk of the Siberian divisions and their armor. The strength of the defenders was now up to over 500,000 men. On December the 5th, Zhukov launched the reserves in a massive counterattack. The Russian offensive was launched along a front 600 miles long. To the Germans, whose own offensive was being carried on with the last ounce of their strength, it came as a hideous shock. Along the entire length of the line, German armies were shattered into thousands of isolated units, fighting desperately for survival. The Battle of Moscow was lost, and with it, the German Wehrmacht had lost the battle for Russia. Although the Russians were strong enough to throw the Germans back from the gates of Moscow and liberate 11,000 towns and villages, they were still nowhere near capable of inflicting a decisive defeat on the invaders. A second counteroffensive in January stalled against increasingly solid German defenses on a line still deep inside the Soviet Union. The battle for Russia had cost the German army 250,000 dead, 500,000 wounded, and most of its tanks. Hitler fired 2 field marshals and 35 generals, but nothing could change the fate to which Germany was now condemned. No new sources of oil or strategic materials had been won, and the Wehrmacht was embroiled in conflicts on 2 fronts. Worst of all, America had entered the war the previous December. Hitler now had to face the very thing he had been desperate to avoid from the start: Russia, Britain, and the United States in an alliance Germany could never hope to defeat.